Since my stream ended. Okay. Hello, everybody, and welcome to this Horasis Global Forum session on GSPDX, which stands for a global search for the next pandemic disease X. The idea is it possible to create a global system comprised of cutting-edge technologies and the right organizational structure to identify the next pathogen currently unknown before it develops into a possible pandemic? So can we stop the next pandemic by identifying a previously unknown disease? And to put that in perspective, as we learned the last time we discussed this topic back at the USA edition of the Horasis Forum, we learned that as far back as in March of 2019, there was a sample of water taken at a telecom fair in Barcelona, which contained traces of the new coronavirus. Unfortunately, that research didn't discover that virus until long afterward, in fact, until just a few months ago. But imagine if we had had really a whole year's head start before the WHO declared COVID-19 a pandemic to begin fighting it and preparing vaccines and learning and how to quarantine and how to social distance. There could have been millions of lives saved. So this is precisely our topic for today. I'm so pleased to begin with a dear friend of mine, Murat Seitnepesov, who will outline for us the vision both in terms of the technologies and what's needed in terms of an organizational structure. Murat is an absolutely brilliant businessman, educated as a plasma physicist in the former Soviet Union. He was a champion of various mathematical and technical and scientific Olympiads in the former Soviet Union. He has founded, built, operated a wide range of companies, both in oil and gas transportation in the Caspian Sea, and now much beyond. He's involved with a commodities trading company that he founded in Geneva, and has been instrumental in working with some brilliant mathematicians in Novosibirsk to develop some algorithmic tools that may enable us to pursue this global system for the prevention of disease X. Murat, I'd like to turn to you first now.
Thank you, Matthew, for the introduction. As you correctly said, it is a global system for the preparedness for disease X. And what does it mean here, global system? Today's knowledge about COVID-19 and other potential epidemics or pandemics are very fragmented. It means a lot of research institutes, a lot of professionals working on this issue, but they have very narrow range of the interests. And what we try to do, we try to create a global system which will accumulate and consolidate all this fragmented knowledge available in the world, and also use modern technologies. It's called fourth industrial revolution technologies, or the digital technologies or technologies of the 21st century, to analyze and produce results based on the existing knowledge already available. Now, we announced this project on 18th of March this year during Horasis U.S. extraordinary meeting. Thanks for Horasis and its chairman, Dr. Frank Richter, for providing platform for this and possibility for this. Now we are 8th of June, and almost 3 months passed, and I would like to share the information what was achieved during this time. And first of all, we think that this idea and this project will be more and more important with the time. And we saw that on 5th of May 2021, at least it means 1 month ago, WHO World Health Organizations announced that they are creating, together with the German government, WHO hub for pandemic and epidemic intelligence. And we think that our project will definitely contribute to this initiative, because the initiative is much, much wider. Now, we created an organizing committee of the project. We created scientific advisory board of the project. Of course, now we invited relevant people, and we are ready to invite more and more professionals from the industry, from the relevant fields of science. Also, we will also enforce the management committee with the time. Now, just last Friday, 4th of June, we filed a patent application for the method and system for detection of the dangerous pathogens and diseases, including unknown, with the Swiss and European patent offices. Our research, as I already told, showed that there are a lot of really good results in that field, but all of them are fragmented and a little bit narrow focused. And that's why it will be very important that our global system will be able to consolidate all this fragmented knowledge and produce consolidated results. And for example, we see with the databases which we had access during these 2 months, they are not really acceptable for the our algorithms and working in our system, because they're again very, very fragmented. And that's why we decided to create our own database and own knowledge base. And we are ready to discuss with the interested counterparties, with the professionals, research institutes, with international organizations, how to create this database and how to integrate the what they have already. And we think that such database should consist from first is a database of parameters and symptoms connected with the dangerous pathogens. Like there is a number of known existing dangerous pathogens, and we need to do the relevance to the parameters and symptoms which these pathogens could cause. Second, we need the database of the known disease, and here we need a big involvement of the professionals from the medicine, doctors, medical doctors. And also we need the microbiological standards of the air, water, and the human body. It means clean, microbiologically clean water, clean air, and a healthy human body. And our scientific team started to work on various elements of this future system. For example, we are doing caffeine analysis now. There are a lot of various research on that field, MIT, Oxford, Cambridge, Switzerland, EPFL, Lausanne, India, Russia, and so on. But there, we didn't see real results. And why so? And we, I think we have a proper approach to this problem, and we are ready to discuss with the professionals and propose our approach to them. And also, we are ready to discuss the limitations and the perspectives of the existing approaches to these problems, and with the modern mathematical theories, for example, stochastic models, taking account the uncertainty. And also we are working in the field of the multi-class classification. And we think that it will be good to arrange a Zoom conference or any other provide conference with the interested people, interested professionals from the industry, doctors, epidemiologists, for example, and to discuss the project at the end of this month. And if somebody is interested, you are welcome to write a message to us on the email address info@sviprode.com. Also, we are studying now proposed applications, for example, like ADA, Symptomate, ORS, and so on. And our goal and our task is creation a system and get the result as, with as less as possible involvement of the human. This is just what we achieved by now, and we are moving forward, and we are happy to have and to invite for cooperation relevant research institutes, epidemiologists, doctors, medical practitioners, in order to consolidate the existing knowledge into our database. And this is just in a few words what we achieved. And thank you, Matthew.
Thank you, Murat. But before I move on to Dr. Carballo, I want to try to summarize for everybody what really this consists of, this initiative, because it's very abstract and it can sound overwhelming. So the idea is that gaining access to existing databases, or as you said, creating your own database, to understand what pathogens are out there, what their symptoms are, and then probably applying some machine learning tools to clean up the data, perhaps, and your algorithmic solutions. I guess it's you identify anomalies as new data comes in so that we see, oh, my goodness, this is a potentially new disease. How could you just expand a little bit on how do you gather the data about the new pathogens that come in? Are there sensors and populated places and transportation hubs or shopping malls? How do you get that new data?
Okay. Yes, Matthew. I a little bit described that during our previous session in March, but I will do it again just to have the full picture for the audience. There are several stages of that project. First stage is collect data. Collect data about known existing pathogens. It could be viruses, it could be bacteria, it will be special proteins, prions, and so on. And we need to collect information about the symptoms and parameters of the human body, and then try to make a relevance between the pathogen and the relevant pathogen, certain pathogen, and certain combination of parameters and symptoms. This is stage number one, and we are now developing the stage, trying to collect data. And we already faced the problem that we were thinking, okay, we go to some research institute and we will get all this such database. Not so, because all databases which we saw, they were very narrow focused, and it's not enough for our machine learning algorithm to proceed. That's why here we are on that stage. Stage number two, we will need real data sets from clinics, like patients coming to the clinic, they had so and so parameters and symptoms like coughing, parameter like high temperature, results from the blood test, and so on. And what was the diagnosis at the end in the clinic? And whether it was an infection disease, whether it was something else. And then our machine learning algorithm could dig these real data sets and learn. Algorithm will learn, will teach itself. Now, the third stage will be the practical implementation or so-called pilot project. Let's say there is an airport, for example, Geneva, Switzerland, where I'm based. And we are going, subject to agreement with the relevant authorities, we are going to implement the sensors and analyzers, which will analyze, for example, temperature of the passengers, thermoscanner, everybody saw this already in airports. Then we are going to constant analysis of the air and the sewage water in the airports, in the toilets, also in the boarding gates, on the security gates, on the entrance, on the exit, and so on and so on. And we already identified several producers of these of such analyzers, which could do constant analysis of the air and to detect even COVID-19 and other pathogens. Then this equipment will be connected to the main database, central database, and where the machine learning algorithm will already know which parameters and symptoms correspond to each pathogen. And here we will be ready to detect already known pathogens. For example, let's take simple thing, COVID-19. And we reached preliminary agreement with one government in the Greater Caspian region who is ready to host the pilot project. And the fourth stage, how to detect unknown pathogens. And here, from one side, is very simple. From the other side, ideologically, maybe a little bit complicated. But the simple thing, if our algorithm will find some really unusual combination of parameters and symptoms together with the analyzing air, sewage water, and temperature, and so on, then this system will do the alert. to the relevant healthcare system or authorities in the relevant country or city or place. And then it will be the task of the existing units, like virus detectives or virus intelligence units. They could do the following analysis, following tests, and try to understand what was this pathogen. But COVID-19 pandemic showed to us that better to prevent at the earliest possible stage than to deal with the consequences. That's why we know that it could be a potential some false positive alerts and so on. It is fine in that in current circumstances that some more people will be properly analyzed, even isolated in the quarantine till the result is known, what was the problem with this particular person, then to leave the pathogen spread over the population. And then we could have the next pandemic. And there are a lot of researches showing that COVID-19 pandemic is not the last pandemic caused by viruses and even by bacteria. And this pandemic, next pandemic will definitely come. This is just in a few words, again, the description of the project.
Thank
you. More detailed information, please contact us. We are ready to share what we have.
Thanks so much, Murat. So now we have an understanding from a sort of a technological perspective and informational perspective what's necessary. But it's a colossal task. I mean, organizationally, the challenge is enormous. And as you said, Murat, in your opening remarks, the World Health Organization has now recently announced that it's going to create a global pathogens intelligence center. So the World Health Organization should play a central role. It wishes to. And I'd like to turn to an epidemiologist with tremendous experience at the WHO to tell us his thoughts on whether it will be able to pull off a task like this. This is Dr. Manuel Carballo. He's executive director of the International Center for Migration, Health and Development in Geneva, and was previously a senior scientist at the World Health Organization in many countries. And among his accomplishments was he led a landmark study on infant and young child feeding. In 1986, he was also one of the three-person team that was asked to develop the World Health Organization's global program on AIDS. He served as World Health Organization public health advisor in Sarajevo during those really challenging years, 1993 to 1995. He also has led development of a series of COVID-19 guidance notes on community quarantine, migrants, humanitarian crises, and midwifery, and led health in crisis assessment missions in Kosovo, Iraq, Iran, and the Palestinian territories, and also was part of the UN relief team after the tsunami in the Maldives. So, Dr. Carballo, what do you think organizationally? How's the World Health Organization going to do, and how daunting is this task?
Well, I was fascinated, as usual, to listen to Murat's explanation of the vision. There could be no better time to go forward with such an initiative. The initiative, as you said, Matthew, is nevertheless grandiose. It is huge. It has lots of requirements, which brings me to the WHO. So keep in mind that WHO is like a club. The members of the club are the ministries of health of all the countries of the world. They're the club and they're the board members. They define what WHO can and cannot, should and should not do. But WHO is mandated by the UN system, by the international community, to lead public health, or what today we increasingly refer to as global health. Now, what are the plus factors for WHO with respect to the ideas that Murat has put forward? First, all countries are members. Secondly, it has the capacity, an official capacity, to issue recommendations. It has the capacity to organize international databases to bring together the data from countries. What are the negative factors? Well, the first is one of the advantages, that it issues recommendations. In other words, it can say things countries are not necessarily expected to follow. They will follow whether it suits them or not. The collection of data for WHO will depend very much on official health statistics. And I think one of the things that we have learned over the years is that official health statistics are variable in quantity, they're variable in quality, and they're highly variable in terms of accessibility. Now, not all countries have good healthcare systems. When Murat is talking about getting data on, for example, the occurrence of certain symptoms, that I think is beyond the existing current WHO system. When Murat talks about bringing together all this global data, as far as WHO is concerned, WHO will have to use the data that a country sends it. I may decide, for example, not to tell WHO that I've had a case of cholera. I don't want to do that because it's going to upset my tourist industry. It's going to upset the way in which my country is perceived. I haven't had time to begin to deal with the infection and so on. So countries may be reluctant to provide data officially. The other thing is, what is the validity of the data? If we look at the situation in India today, there are estimations being made that the COVID-19 mortality rate may be 3 to 4 times higher than what has been officially recorded and submitted internationally. So validity of data will always reflect the extent to which a country has been able to gather the data and whether the data are good or not. The other thing that we need to keep in mind is that behind this initiative that Murat has described is speed. The ability through this algorithmic method to identify, and by the way, I would like to say here, it's not simply new pathogens. It is existing pathogens that have the potential to become epidemic or pandemic. And this, I think, is a critical issue. We may know that there is a certain pathogen existing in the Geneva airport. So what? Is it likely to spread? How far is it likely to spread? What are the factors that will facilitate the spread? And what will be the potential speed of that spread and the number of people affected? These are issues that we will need to address. So again, coming back to WHO, speed in WHO is a major difficulty in the sense that it has to respond to countries, to its board members. It has to get the board members to agree to something. It has to agree, get the board members to agree to allow a particular statement to be made or data to be shared and so on. Validity of data will always be a problem because it has to go on official data. And official data vary, as I said before, in terms of quantity, quality, and validity. So I think that coming directly to your question, how well is WHO disposed to handle this? I think only time will tell. As of today, I would say that it has lots of barriers to it. Whether the initiative that it has taken with the German government to create a data hub may overcome this. But again, the same issues will be relevant. Official data versus unofficial data and validity of data. Murat has brought up a very interesting idea, and that is to look for a combination of symptomatic or symptom data. And I think that that opens up a whole new area of research, which will depend on the capacity of general practitioners and others to gather data, to send data, to alert data, alert on data. But a very, very interesting new formulation. So I think those, Matthew, would be some of my concerns. I would like to add that pandemic preparedness is going to have to look at non-health data as well. The fact that pathogens may exist, to what extent will they become epidemic or pandemic, is going to depend on a variety of social, environmental factors. For example, I was thinking this morning about the issue of speed of spread. And everybody talks about migration, migrants, and so on. But in fact, the year before COVID-19, the number of tourists moving around the world was 1.8 billion. Short trips, long trips. But these are trips that can very easily constitute the vehicles for the spread of the pathogen, whether it's an existing or a newer combination, a mutant, whatever. So these are factors. The other issue that concerns me particularly is environment. And when we talk about environment, people think about immediately climate change, and climate change clearly is going to be a critical factor in the issue of the origin of new pathogens or the spread of existing pathogens or mutant pathogens. But in particular, environment also refers to the biosocial conditions in which people today are living. And I have mentioned before the fact that the urban slums that are being formed rapidly throughout the world in developing countries constitute perhaps some of the most optimal conditions for the emergence of new pathogens or the spread or accelerated spread of existing pathogens. Do I have any more minutes left to me, Matthew?
Sure.
Pandemic preparedness also, keep in mind, is always difficult in the sense that Murat may call me up one day and say, as I'm appointing myself Minister of Health, and say, we believe that there is a new pathogen emerging in one of your cities. We predict that this is going to become a serious issue or what WHO would consider a disease of concern, international concern, of epidemic concern, and then of pandemic concern. Now, so what do I do with that? Do I do anything? Well, I think the history of COVID-19 has shown that countries do not sometimes choose to do anything. So availability of data and predictions will only be useful if we can encourage countries to act on those data. And I think that calls for a whole new approach to pandemic preparedness. And keep in mind that pandemic preparedness is inevitably risky and costly. Mm-hmm. I remember very well how in the United States there was a prediction of a swine fever outbreak, and the person who was head of DHSS alerting all the states and taking phenomenal steps to prepare for this. And of course, it never occurred. And he lost his job because of that. So there is cost involved. There is resources required to prepare it. All of that said, I think that this initiative that Murat has described is extraordinarily timely, has potentially magnificent benefit, is multifactorial, multisectorial, and is going to require a type of data collection that in itself is a major challenge. But I think it's an extraordinary opportunity that we have in front of us. Thank you, Martin.
Wow, thank you so much, Manuel. I mean, you brought us beyond even this colossal initiative to help contemplate the enormity of the task of getting society writ large prepared. By the way, there's also the issue, I guess, of the loss of biodiversity, which can make it easier for pathogens to jump from animals to humans. So, yeah, it's a task that all of society is going to have to lean into. And yes, I obviously come from a country where in the beginning, our government did not take COVID-19 seriously at all, and even called it a political hoax. So if that's your starting point, it seems it's very difficult to move forward. On the other hand, I'm drawing on what you said in your opening remarks and describing how the World Health Organization operates, it's ultimately going to be its member states that have to provide the impetus or the political motivation for the WHO to play whatever coordinating role it might play. So our political leaders have great responsibility.
Matthew, just in response to that, just one second.
Sure.
I think the beauty of what Murat is proposing, and which could overcome some of the resistance that you have just described with regard to thinking something is a hoax, is the fact that he's talking about mathematical algorithms.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
These are highly scientific.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that that could overcome, help to overcome some of the fastidious sort of, oh, is this true? Could it be true? Is it a hoax or not? Mathematical algorithms, I think, are more credible today than any other source of information. Thank you.
What a great point. Thank you. To reflect on all this, I'd like to turn to a true Renaissance man, Professor Dr. Ernesto Kahan. He is no longer a practicing epidemiologist, but he's now spending his time painting, as you can see over his left shoulder, his beautiful painting about COVID-19. He's sculpting, writing books. He's a poet. He was born in Argentina and was the deputy director at the Ministry of Health until the 1976 coup attempt there, in which case, or after which, he migrated to Israel. And in Israel, he was the deputy director of the Rabin Medical Center, the head of the Department of Epidemiology at the Institute of Occupational Health at Tel Aviv University. He's also the former vice president of the International Physicians for the Prevention of Nuclear War, which won the Nobel Peace Prize in 1985. And I just like to remind Ernesto, at that time, I was taking a seminar on accidental nuclear war with his partner in this great endeavor, Dr. Herb Abrams, the late Herb Abrams, at Stanford University. The awards that Ernesto has achieved would take us all day to recite. But he's a member, an academician, and a member of the North American Academy of Modern International Literature. And one honorary degree that stands out that really underscores his diversity is his honorary doctorate at the Mongolian Academy of Sciences. So he really spans the world. He's worked and taught in universities all across Latin America and in the United States. And so, Professor Kahan, what does it all mean?
I'm so happy and fascinated listening to you, my friends, Murat, with the presentation of the project, which is superb. It depends now on the efficiency of the implementation, because there are many factors there. And also the presentation of Manuel Carballo, who put the all the situation of the notification and the actions in under the possibility of epidemics and pandemics was superb, really. Following your request, Matthew, I will present some questions or some aspects related to the political and philosophical implementation of and consequences of this epidemic and pandemic. So by this, we can really evaluate the really real importance of this project that I am so happy to be part of it. You know, coronavirus tell us that this pandemic put in crisis health, economy, political, communities, nations, and also social relationship with the people. Though we have many examples in the world that the appearance of serious epidemics and pandemics produces significant impact on all societies and countries. This impact is medical, social, economical, as I say before, also philosophical. Since in the history, we have very significant changes in the lifestyle of political organization of societies because of the pandemic. I give you only two examples or three examples. The first one in 1358, in the middle of the Middle Age, with a lot of social and political problems, was appear the Black Peace. And the Black Peace, just for example, I'll tell you that in Florence, only one-fifth of all the population survived. So you can imagine the impact of this. The other epidemic is the so-called Spanish flu in 1918. In the middle of this pandemic, not by chance, occurred in the middle of the First World War. And all the men are in the front. Women, for first time in society, are taking social responsibility and economical responsibility in the society. So what happened in these two epidemics? When people ask questions and the questions cannot be solved, cannot be answered, incredibility way, people are looking for new things. In the Middle Ages, in 1358, they didn't believe in the monarchy, they didn't believe in the church, because all the people, the church people and non-believers, they died, everybody. So they were looked into the philosophy of old Greek and old Roman. So, and what happened? After 10,000 years of the revolution, agricultural revolution, which changed everything in society, after 10,000 years appeared the second important revolution in the world. We call it now, or humanism, or if you want, the Renaissance. And this is because of the pandemic. Between other examples, 1918, in the middle of the First World War, appeared the flu, Spanish flu. 100 million people died in Europe, in a Europe in which Paris has only 5,000 population. 100 million died because of this disease. And what happened? Stop and finish the war. Women request to new rights to participate in society, the vote, was created against the war, the Society of Nations, and after that the UN. So I don't know what could happen after this pandemic of COVID-19. But this is so important that the societies must be prepared, as my friend Manuel said, because today they were not prepared. They are not prepared at all. So the pandemic took all the governments without answer. So now we are talking about pathogens. There are pathogens in humans, but there are also pathogens in non-humans. Mm-hmm. Today, just last week, was detected one case of avian flu in China. Mm. So big question. Mm. It could be an epidemic in human of avian flu. We know that if this happened, it would be even more aggressive and terrible than the coronavirus. Wow. So I'm very, very supporting of this new project. And this project must be start in small places or small countries, because it's not easy to implement it. But we have to be with all the ears and eyes looking at what happened and making the enormous corrections. And also make, as Manuel said, pressure to the countries, to the government of the countries, in order to take measures. To be prepared. To be prepared is the answer. Because no preparedness is it can be a death of the new society. In moments today in which there are plans for taking our freedom. Mm-hmm. And there are many examples for that. I don't want to go into it because we don't have too much time for that.
Yeah.
So thank you very much for having giving me the opportunity to say that.
Wow. Thank you, Ernesto, for the beautiful, powerful summing up of what this is all about. We're just about out of time, so we won't have any more questions, I think. But, you know, you really brought out why we need to, as you said, keep the pressure on our governments. We need the leadership of wise leaders. Thank goodness President Biden has reestablished the White House office for a global effort to fight future pandemics. That's not enough. This is one issue, though, preventing the next pandemic, being ready. That's the one issue that overcomes all of the turbulence in my country's relations, in U.S. relations with China and with Russia. This is the one issue of all. Where we really have some hope and being motivated to work together. So thank you, everybody who was with us. And I think we're out of time. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.